Hello, I am Jacob from Intrepid ProtoWorks. I'm a human factors consultant, and today I want to spend a little time taking a high-level look at human error. We all make mistakes. As Alexander Pope said, to err is human. However, there is more to that topic. I'm sure many of us have accidentally hit send on a text that was not ready, or that was possibly not intended to be sent in the first place. Sigmund Freud promoted the idea of what would come to be known as the Freudian slip. You know, when you say one thing and you mean your mother. Sorry, bad joke. So, that is to say, the concept of the Freudian slip is simply that you accidentally misspeak, but in the process, you say what is actually on your mind. So, you have probably been in a frustrating situation before. You say, push a button in a game, and the wrong thing happens, and you are sure you push the right button, but say, your character plummets to their doom all the same. For another example, you are playing a player versus player PvP game, and you attempt to attack another player, but your shot or attack or whichever makes the most sense in this situation does not land. You're certain you had hit your mark, you're certain you had the correct aim, or button combo, or whichever. In both situations, you feel slighted, and your enjoyment of the experience tanks. Well, the reality of the situation is that you are probably making some sort of error. Now, on the positive side, just because you're the one slipping up or making a mistake does not always mean it is your fault either. Though, that is not to say you can always shift the blame. When we talk about mistakes colloquially, we can mean any number of different things. Everything we have talked about so far could be called a mistake. However, it is a little bit different once we start talking about the term scientifically. Mistakes are one of a few ways to categorize where human error comes from. Some of the popular sources to look at include the aforementioned mistakes, but also includes slips, cognitive biases, and design error, among others. Tonight, we are just going to go over mistakes, slips, and cognitive biases. So, the remainder of this video will be a short look into these topics. Bear in mind, as well, that each of these bullet points has many lifelong professionals studying them. So there's no way we could fully do each of these topics justice. If there is an additional interest in this down the line, we can take a deeper dive into them, however. So why is this helpful to look at? What makes human error a compelling and important topic? Well, it is great to be able to understand why you have made a mistake or an error of some sort. It can be humbling and is a great source of self-improvement. This topic may also give you a lot of insight into why many different things are made the way they are. Because, other than what the object was designed for, very often it is the case that the first in line of the secondary goal for that object's software service is to reduce the number of errors while interacting with it. Simply, we want to do a thing with the thing without messing up the thing we're doing. Now, if you're a designer, or a maker, or an engineer, or a web designer, or a software designer, the list goes on, you probably want people to have a good time using your product, at least in all the ways you think that the product may need to be used. Though, sometimes that is not the case, but that is a topic for another time. If you are in any of these areas, you can benefit greatly from understanding that there are a lot of ways you can make a product that can reduce error and in turn increase efficiency and increase performance with whatever you're making. You can start from a basic understanding of different human errors and work your way down, trying to head off those issues as the development process goes forward. Now let us talk more precisely about some of these elements of human error. We will start with slips. So, broadly, slips are more or less behaviors where what you are doing and what you are thinking do not match, or your behavior does not match your understanding, and your understanding is correct, just your behavior does not match to yield the desired outcome. So a slip is typically a situation where you have the correct understanding, but somewhere along the way, you do the wrong thing, you do the wrong behavior. This can be in your movements, or your motor function. The information you take in is, you know, maybe processed incorrectly, or there's some kind of other perceptual problem. Or you can even have some other cognitive process which messes with how you handle pursuing a task. But your knowledge on the task overall is correct. Arthur Norman in 2002 discussed 6 types of slips that we'll go over tonight. And again, a little familiarity here can provide a lot of help when designing a piece of software or product or a physical device. So here are some slips. The first one we'll talk about tonight is called a capture error. This is when a common behavior takes over for an intended behavior. So let's say you're playing a game and you have a common skill or attack you need to use, but suddenly you need to use a different skill or attack. Even though you recognize that you need to do one thing, you ended up doing the more common one accidentally. This is also the common source of jokes and pranks. So, for example, let's talk about a joke. What do you put in your cereal? Milk. What do you add to chocolate to drink it? Milk. What do babies drink? Milk. What does milkman deliver? Milk. What does a cow drink? Did you say milk or water? For those of you who said milk, you arguably just made a capture error. Next, we'll look at description errors. So in this situation, you did what you could with the information you had. However, you made the wrong choice of behavior. This is because the behavior has a lot in common with the others, and you may have been working with incomplete information. So in the end, you can end up doing the correct action to the wrong thing. A simple example of this would be clicking the cancel button when you intended to click the save button, or maybe clicking to subscribe to a newsletter on accident. Interestingly enough, there are a lot of websites which bank on you accidentally opting into their newsletters. The next type of slip is what we call a data-driven error. This is simply when one piece of information may interfere with another, resulting in the wrong behavior. This can also be phrased as initiating a behavior at the wrong time due to some sort of external input. An example of this could be naming a file incorrectly because you just heard or read something else. For example, if you name the subject line of an email after a song you just heard on the radio. We then have associative activation errors. The main difference is that it is some sort of internal thought or state which triggers a behavior at the wrong time. Have you ever responded to a question someone did not ask you during a conversation? Yeah, that could be an example of an associative activation error. Now, on the other end of the spectrum, there's also a loss of activation error. This one is pretty simple. It is when you forget to do something, so forgetting to grab your keys on the way out the door. The last slip I want to talk about for now is the mode error. Have you ever started to drive off, but your vehicle is accidentally in reverse rather than drive? Yeah, that could be a mode error. So you'll notice a lot of times I say that could be a type of error. Without having a lot of insight into what a person is doing and why, sometimes there's often ambiguity into the type of error they're making. That's okay. A lot of times these sorts of examples work just fine all the same. So that is all I wanted to talk about for slips right now. I also want to talk a little bit about mistakes. A mistake is a behavior which is based on incorrect knowledge. This can either be that you are simply wrong about a rule or a fact or something similar. It could also be due to missing information as well. We'll probably go into this in greater detail later, as mistakes could be a video unto themselves. So an example of a mistake could be driving down the wrong direction of a one-way street. Additionally, a common way of phrasing the categorization of errors would either be as execution errors, like the slips we talked about above, or as planning errors, which are mistakes. So in general, our brains take a lot of shortcuts every day, all the time. We never stop taking shortcuts. And these shortcuts are a whole range of different things, everything from information processing heuristics to pruning out what we are taking in when we are seeing things in our day-to-day life. These shortcuts are essential, and without them, we wouldn't be able to function. However, as important as these shortcuts are, they can also often lead to problems. And one common way to refer to these problems are cognitive biases. So, as a way of looking at how mistakes may occur, how planning errors may occur, we are going to look at some of these biases. This isn't the only way that mistakes or planning errors can happen, but it's going to be the one that we look at tonight. Now, will a cognitive bias always be present during a mistake? No. Will a cognitive bias always lead to a mistake? No, it will not. However, there is a lot of overlap, so much so that it is often a good practice to consider your own bias, and if you are a developer for any sort of product, service, or software, it could be that a lot of your sources of systematic error on the part of your user base can sometimes be explained by the presence of cognitive biases. Sometimes, also unfortunately, biases are even used against people for different reasons. Suffice it to say, considering cognitive bias as a means to understanding human error is a strong starting point to a much more involved process. So now on to some basic definitions of some of the more well-known cognitive biases. Let's start off with one of the most common, the gambling fallacy. It is one of the most common cognitive biases you'll hear people talk about. In it, a person thinks there is a pattern where there are just random numbers. You'll often hear statements like, "My dice are cold," "My cards are hot," or something similar. The thing is, we want to see patterns all the time, and sometimes we find them when they are not there. The next cognitive bias I want to talk about is insensitivity to sample size. This is a little bit more difficult to understand. This is where we are incorrectly surprised at seeing an extreme result in a large sample or set of experiences. Think about that one friend who you think is ridiculously lucky. Well, how many people have you seen go through a similar set of experiences? Is it really so surprising that you see somebody hit that kind of luck? Possibly no. Next, let's talk about incorrect revision of probabilities. So as you are going through a task, you are taking in information on what you think the outcome of it might be, or if you're going through a series of tasks repeatedly, you may incorrectly evaluate the chance of different outcomes. Another really common heuristic is the availability heuristic. This is where you believe that something may or may not happen because of past experience. Also, because of the way human memory works, which can be an entire set of videos unto themselves, we may also let recent events incorrectly slant our perception of the probability of upcoming events. The next cognitive bias I want to talk about is an interesting one. It's simply called attribution error. So this is where we may attribute our own actions as a byproduct of the environment, while somebody else watching us will attribute our actions to our character. For example, a soldier may see themselves as only doing what is asked of them, while an observer may call them a hero. Or conversely, one person says that they are only doing what they needed so that they could survive, while a person who is observing may call them a criminal. This is something we see very often, and this is something that I think many people would be well served considering carefully when they evaluate the actions of those around them. The last cognitive bias I want to talk about tonight is the general problem with reconstructive memory. So every time we remember something, we are more or less reconstructing the experience. At least that's one of the popular theories on how memory works, and it's a good one. The details of that are an entire video unto itself, though. But where the bias comes in is that we often change how we remember something based off of other things we are thinking about. There are a lot of great examples of this. So let's look at a classic. Let's say that you have some sort of neutral interaction with a romantic interest. Then let's say you do poorly on a test of some sort, not even related to this aforementioned interaction, or, you know, some other sort of event that was unpleasant. When you go back to think on that neutral experience, you being emotionally depressed or in other ways compromised can possibly make you actually think more negatively about that experience upon sequential recollection when you remember it again. So this is a pretty good start to a talk about human error. Again, like I've said before, this is a vast field that many, many researchers have dedicated their careers to. There's a lot more we can cover, and if you are interested, let us know, and we will expand on this in any number of different ways. If you have any questions or comments, be sure to let us know down in the comments below, and do not forget to like, subscribe, and sign up for notifications for when our videos come out.